importantly. Fine, it continued more or less even in the era of Shah Jahan, but by the time of Aurangzeb came, of course, painting and other art, art and architecture had no much importance in the court of Aurangzeb. That's what we also know. So, idea is that we have to explain about the Jahangir's era's contribution and how the European impact was there on the Mughal painting overall. And this is what actually the Mughal painting in this era is also known as the miniature painting, because here the small, you can say, elements were largely, of course, painted, and naturalism became the feature of the miniature painting at this particular point of time. So this is how we have to explain about the impact of European impact on the Mughal painting at that particular point of time as well. Fine, that is the point. Then we have the assess this statement that philosophy of Shankaracharya revolutionized religious thoughts in India. Now this is another very important question. That's the reason why you can see it is given in 20 words, in fact, question, 20 marks question. So philosophy of Shankaracharya revolutionized religious thought. That's what is a very important point. Now the point that we have to understand that what was before the era of Shankaracharya. See, Shankaracharya era started in the 8th century CE only. Alright, so before 8th century CE in India, what was the condition? And after the 8th century CE in India, what was the condition? See, in this particular era, of course, the so-called Brahmanism or Hinduism was in decline. Alright, it was in decline, especially I'm talking about the, let's say, the Gupta and post-Gupta time. So it was in decline, of course, and it was being dominated by the Buddhism too much in India. So Buddhism was a dominant religion in this particular era. Now Hinduism is said to have revived. Hinduism is said to have revived only through Shankaracharya. So Shankaracharya, a particular seer who was born in Kerala, now he actually, in fact, for the first time, he practiced about the philosophy of Advait. Alright, so Advait philosophy was proposed by him. It was basically monism, where he talked about that the God and Atma both are same. Now see, where he talked about for the first time that the soul is with the universe only. Alright, so soul has come out from universe only. That is what actually was the philosophy of monism was there. Now, this is not the philosophy that actually revolutionized the entire concept. Rather, what he talked about for the first time, he spoke about the reform in Vedas and Upanishads. So what did he do? He brought a reform in the Vedic and Upanishadic practices, especially rituals. So rituals need to be reformed altogether so that the problem or the evil practices inside Hindus or Hinduism. So evil practices inside Hinduism, it has come because of the, of course, because of the problem of, because of the problem in Hinduism, and due to which only Hinduism is on decline, alright, in India at that particular point of time. So evil practices inside Hinduism needs to be reformed, and it has to be reformed with the new interpretation of the Vedic and the Upanishadic rituals. So Vedic and Upanishadic rituals and the hymns should be reinterpreted in the light of rationalism. In the light of rationalism, and this is how he brought a new, you can say, set of enthusiasm in Hinduism. So because of that only he contributed in revolutionizing the religious thoughts in India at that particular point of time. And therefore, because of his contribution only, you see that by 9th to 11th century CE, because of Shankaracharya only, various, you can say, mathas or mutts were opened across India, right from Dwarka in Gujarat to Sringeri in Karnataka to Puri in Odisha to Badrinath in Uttarakhand. So you can see in the west, in the south, in the east, and in the north. So there were four, you can say, religious shrines or religious places that actually had been designed by Shankaracharya. It is said that Sringeri was much designed by Shankaracharya only, but today this has become one of the most important rituals of Hinduism to visit these particular religious places in India today. So of course by the time when you can say Ramanuj came, so Ramanuj period was in 11th century, the time when Ramanuj came, he was already got the background prepared by Shankaracharya, and after Ramanuj, of course, he came into picture, he propounded many of the, of course, theories to reform the Hinduism, and because of Ramanuj's contribution also, Hinduism again got a huge boost, and finally, in the time of Cholas, again Hinduism found a revival. Alright, so of course, there was a conflict between the issue of, let's say, the Nayanars or Alwars. Of course, the Alwars were the followers of the Vishnu, and Nayanars were the followers of Shiv. Alright, so of course this Shaivite and Vaishnavite religion also got a huge boost after the entry of Ramanuj in the entire episode of the, you can say, the religious revolution in India in the 11th century CE. So you can see the philosophy of Shankaracharya actually contributed revolutionary, you can say, change in the religious thoughts in India at that particular point of time, and therefore after him Ramanuj, Vallabhacharya, Madhavacharya, alright, Chaitanya, etc., they all came to revive and reform the Hinduism and again bring back Hinduism on the forefront of the entire Indian, you can say, religious practices. And therefore you can see the Buddhism also started declining after this, and Hinduism started picking up tremendously in Indian history altogether. That actually, this entire episode has to be analyzed in this particular question by all of you. That's actually the point. Fine. Then you can see a state of agriculture, delineate the state of agriculture in the Sultanate period. Now this question is equally very interesting. I mean, see, this question is simply asking you that you have to state the state of agriculture in Sultanate period. Now point is that what you have to explain in this particular question. Now agriculture itself is a very big issue. So what you have to explain here, first of all, what is the what are crops that were produced in the Sultanate period in agriculture? That's one thing. Secondly, you have to also explain about the kind of land that was used for the agriculture in Sultanate period, and how the measurement was done on agricultural land at that particular point of time, and how the taxations were also charged from agriculture at that point of time. Then you have to also explain about the status of irrigation in agriculture at that particular point of time. Then you have to also explain about the kind of farmers, the type of farmers who were involved in agriculture at that point of time. Fine. Then you have to also talk about the state support to agriculture at that point of time. For example, let's say the credit facilities, a loan that we know about in the form of Sondhar and Takkavi loan. Alright, so these all practices you have to explain in that particular manner only. And last but not the least, the kind of technology that we introduced in agriculture at that point of time. Alright, so technology, that is very important to be mentioned over here, especially the Persian wheel that we used in agriculture, which actually revolutionized our entire, you can say, cultural practices at that point of time. So obviously on these particular lines only you have to give the argument about the kind of state of agriculture that was in existence in entire Sultanate period. Fine. And once you have talked about that, then you have to also explain about the brief shortcomings. The brief shortcomings in agriculture, especially in the context of the agriculture revolt that took place largely in the era of MBT, Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So it is said that more than 23 revolts took place in his era by the agriculturists because of heavy taxation and lack of focus or lack of support by the state or on the farmers at a particular point of time. So this is how you can also mention about the limitations of agriculture at that particular point of time. That's what actually was the issue to be analyzed here. Fine. Then we have Sufi and Bhakti thoughts ennobled Indian psyche amidst the vagaries of time elucidate. Simply you have to understand that Sufi and Bhakti thoughts, it actually provided a reprosma between the two competing ideologies. Alright. So of course it is also said to be that Sufism, Bhaktism provided a base for the emergence of composite culture. Now the composite culture that emerged in the time of the Mughal period actually got a background in the emergence of Sufism and Bhaktism in India. Now see, Sufism and Bhaktism emerged in India during that particular point of time when in India there was already a lot of contrast being witnessed in the entire Indian cultural scenario. So see, you see the idea of Arab invasion took place, the Islamic invasion took place, or the Muslim invasion took place in India. So because of those invasions also there was a cultural, you can see differences, cultural problem that started cropping up in Indian society at that particular point of time. Fine. So because of that only, the Sufism provided a base. Sufism provided a base for the Islamic religion to be softened, to be, you can say, moderate enough to accommodate the local peoples and their cultural into that. And because of those factors only, you see, Sufism provided a very strong background to have a strong government in India in the form of the Delhi Sultanate. So Delhi Sultanate was possible because of the background created by Sufism only. All right. At the same time, Bhaktism also provided a very strong base for the cultural, you can say, tension that was there in the society at that particular point of time. So devotion to God was very important in Bhaktism, and that exactly was also the base for Bhaktism that came up in India. Because within Hinduism also there was a lot of conflict between, let's say, Alwars versus Nayanars also. Alright, even in the context of the Krishnite cult emerged, the Mite cult emerged. So with these cults also started coming up at that particular point of time, and Bhaktism provide a common base to among all these cults. Alright, that is also another very important observation about Bhaktism in India. So with this you can understand that how Sufism and Bhaktism, they provided a very comfortable, you can say, psyche for the Indians at that particular point of time in the early medieval and medieval period altogether. That's what we have to explain about this idea. Fine. So Sufism and Bhaktism in that way. Then emergence of early capitalism in Mughal period was primarily due to urbanization and commercialization. Now see, Mughals, or in fact I would say in the words of Irfan Habib or even Muhammad Habib. See, Muhammad Habib, father of Irfan Habib, had given a concept of urban revolution. Fine. So urban revolution took place also during time of the Sultanate period. That's what Muhammad Habib has talked about. Because this Islamic population who came down to India from Central Asia, they were mainly having this urban, you can say, test. So because of that only, they promoted urbanization altogether. And by the time when Mughal period came into existence, of course, urbanization and commercialization had already taken shape in terms of connecting the Indian territory with the Central Asian territory and also Indian territory to the Southeast Asian territory at that particular point of time. So because of these factors only, it also led to the growth of many of the urban centers and finally also the growth of many of the merchandise class in India. So baniyas, merchants, sarafs, these all actually emerged at a particular point of time only. And because of the coastal trade, because of the internal trade, external trade, because of these all factors, of course, the early capitalism definitely got immersed in this particular point of time in the Mughal period only. And Sirin Musbi, W.H. Moreland, fine, and even Irfan Habib, now they all actually have been of this opinion that, of course, due to urban centers and commercialization, the capitalism also started taking shape in the Mughal period as well. But this capitalism was not led by the state, unlike the capitalism that was there in the context of the Western countries in the form of mercantilism. Alright, that is actually the problem, and that's the reason why you see the Mughal could not optimize upon capitalism the way the Britishers were able to optimize upon their sort of capitalism because of the earlier practices of mercantilism. Alright, so finally mercantilism changed into capitalism in Europe, unlike in India. That is the point here we have to understand. Fine. And besides, you know that the Mughals didn't have a strong navy. That is the weakest part of entire Mughal administration, that they did not have any naval force. That is the point. Fine. Then you have the next question. Internal strife, conflict beset with personal ambitions was enough for an invitation for the Ghurids to invade India. So you have to understand that there was already a problem internally in India, and because of that only the Muhammad Ghurs invasion took place in India. So in northwestern area there were various principalities And because of those principalities, like Hindu Sahi kingdom was there, then other kingdoms were there in the entire North India, and there was no unanimity, though there was no unity among those smaller kingdoms. And there was already a rivalry between the Rajput kingdoms at that particular point of time. Because of that only, of course, despite the fact that in the first battle of Tarayan, the Rajput brothers were able to register a victory. Of course, in the second battle of Tarayan, that was exposed in the context of the lack of unity among the Rajput kingdoms, and because of that only Muhammad Ghori became successful in defeating in 1192, the second battle of Tarayan, the Indian power. Of course, with that, the entire Prithviraj era came to an end. Fine. That is how we also know about this story. So this story has to be explained in that particular idea only. Fine. Feudalism was there, Rajput kingdoms were there, lack of unity was there, because of that only the Ghurids were able to invade India successfully. Then you have next question, that is the Mughals built the titans and embellished like jewelers. Now see, this is what actually you have to understand, that the Mughals built the titans, built like titans and embellished like jewelers. So idea is that in the Mughal period, especially under the period of Akbar and Shahjahan, very big buildings were constructed in India. The architecture of entire medieval India attained a peak in the era of either Akbar or Shahjahan. Fine. So you can see those examples in the form of, let's say, the Buland Darwaja made by Akbar, or let's say the another important monuments like Taj Mahal, Red Fort, alright. So these all major, Jama Masjid, these all major monumental architecture under the era of Shahjahan. That is another very important example to understand that they built like titans, alright. And of course, they also introduced Pitra Diura and other very important techniques, other important techniques to beautify those marvelous structure. That is how they also acted like a jewelers to bring more and more beautification in those marvelous structure in India. That's what actually we have to also understand. And the point is that they were also ready to accept and borrow the local features in their architectural pattern altogether. Whether Jali is there, whether the motifs are there, whether the patterns were there, they also were borrowed from the local, you can say, Pahari culture, the local, you can say, the North Indian culture, they also were borrowed from there. This is how the best of the culture actually came out in the period of Shahjahan. That's what actually we know in the form of the monumental structure like Taj Mahal and also Red Fort, the Jama Masjid in Delhi. So this actually became still the heritage of India for all of us. That's what actually was the contribution of these particular rulers, Mughals in fact. Then you have next question, that is question number 8a. So critically analyze whether the success of the Mughals is to be credited to their robust Jagirdari and Mansabdari system. So of course you need to understand that Jagirdari and Mansabdari system provided two very important things for the British, Mughals. One is that administrative control that was given to them through the Mansabdari system. Another one is the revenue control that was given to them through the Jagirdari system. So both administration and revenue became institutionalized under the Mughals, and that became the most important strength of the Mughals. And that's the reason why the emergence of Mughals as a power was based upon the Mansabdari introduced by Akbar, based upon the Jagirdari introduced by Akbar, and because of these factors only, the Akbar is said to be the founder of the Mughal Empire in India. And then you also see when the weak rulers of Mughal came, of course these became also the factors for their decline, because if the Mansabdari system started weakening, Jagirdari system started weakening, of course they also declined gradually. That is how decline of Mughals was also based upon the problem in Jagirdari crisis or even the Mansabdari crisis, in the words of Satish Chandra and Irfan Habib, in the context of the decline of the Mughals as well. Fine. So we'll discuss all these things in detail in class. So I'm simply giving you the brief idea about what is to be written in these all questions. Fine. Then it was, next question, it was as much the court intrigues as also the defiance of the provincial powers that hastened the decline of the Mughals in the 18th century. Now this exactly is correct, because after the decline or demise of Aurangzeb, the court intrigues in the Mughals started increasing tremendously. You can understand that there have been more than a dozen of rulers that came into picture between 1707 to 1857 in India at that particular point of time. Fine. So after the demise of Aurangzeb only, there was a war of succession started taking place inside the court of Mughals, and because of that only there has been a weakening of power inside the Mughals altogether. Alright. And at the same time, with the Mughals started getting weakened, the regional powers, the provincial powers, they started becoming very powerful. And that's what actually we have to understand in the context of the emergence of the provincial kingdoms like Bengal, like Hyderabad, like Awadh, alright, so even like Marathas. So they also started emerging as a major powerful entities at that particular point of time in the 18th century. This all aspects have to be explained in this particular question very clearly. Fine. The last question is, Shivaji was not merely a military conqueror but also an enlightened ruler, discuss. Of course, it is correct. Shivaji was not at all a military conqueror only. See, Shivaji was the founder of the Maratha Empire altogether, and Maratha being initially a group of, let's say, the soldiers, a group of fighters. Now they acquired a shape of a caste gradually. So Maratha, they actually came out from the root of their concept farming. They finally took up arms in their hand under leadership of Shivaji, and finally they acquired a new caste dimension altogether in entire region of Maharashtra. In the words of Andhra Wink, there was Andhra Wink has talked about a concept of fitna. So fitna was the cause of the emergence of the Marathas in Maharashtra. So the point is that, of course, Shivaji was not only a military conqueror, so he provided a base for the emergence of Maratha Empire. And at the same time, since he provided a base for Maratha Empire, he also set up the institution in Maratha Empire, like As Pradhan was established, in which the 8 highest officials, including the ministers who were appointed by him, which provided a strong base to the entire Maratha Empire. And therefore, you can understand Maratha had become a very strong empire and having a sort of a ambition to create a Hindu empire in entire India. That's what is called as Hindu Patpat Sahi. Fine, so Hindu Patpat Sahi could have been possible under the leadership of Bajirao first, but of course there were certain problems. That's the reason why Hindu empire could not be established. But nevertheless, Maratha Empire was there as a very formidable empire after the demise of even Aurangzeb in the entire Deccan region. Fine, that is what was the military conqueror, how he was military conqueror. But he was also an enlightened ruler, and therefore what Shivaji did, he introduced various reforms in the society, especially for the farmers. He introduced reforms for the farmers in the form of, he started the practice of measurement based taxation structure inside the entire Deccan area. Fine. At the same time, he started offering loans to the farmers, like Takavi loans to the farmers to do practice of farming at that particular point of time. He reduced the taxation from the farmers at that point of time. So these all activities only, he was also an enlightened ruler who wanted to promote the concerns of the downtrodden section of society. And that's the reason why precisely, that is exactly the reason why he acquired enormous support from the ground to his leadership. Therefore, he became a very popular leader at that point of time, even popular more than, of course, Aurangzeb, as far as the Hindu or all the so-called non-Muslim population of that particular era was concerned. So exactly this way, you can understand he was contemporary to Aurangzeb, and he was equally challenging the entire authority of Aurangzeb with a sheer, you can say, popularity and sheer support of the local population in entire Marathwada area or entire region of